Welcome to the fifth lecture in the series Signification in Buddhist and French Traditions. In the fourth lecture, we discussed the theory of names in both the Buddhist and French traditions. In the fifth lecture, we concentrate on the theory of names or conceptual constructs by Condillac, the 18th century French logician. First, an introductory note. The essays for L'origine des connaissances humaines of Etienne Bonneau de Condillac was published in Amsterdam in 1746. Inspired by the treatise of the English philosopher John Locke, Essay Concerning Human Understanding, 1690, with whom he often disagreed on some vital theoretical issues, the French philosopher continued and developed the basic Abelardian hypothesis of sensus imaginatio intellectus in the creation and the diffusion of signification in linguistic communication. The historian of linguistic theory and epistemology, Sylvain Houroux, has denominated the Condillacian enterprise as linguistic conceptualism, as opposed to nominalism, the same epithet that was used for Abelardian reflections on language a century earlier by Victor Cousin. Now we begin with the reflections of Condillac. First of all, there is a movement from perception to imagination. The external world and its sensations activate our spirit to reflect, to imagine. Sensations are the basic material for all our knowledge. So, the basis all of our knowledge is senses, but we don't stay there. That is the difference. All our needs are held by each other in such a way that our perceptions are ordered in a certain chain of fundamental ideas to which others are attached that part a form of our knowledge. Over each of them is a series of others which form a chain that is based entirely on the analogy of signs in the order of perception and in the liaison of the circumstances that unite at times the most disparate ideas. To each is related another that is supposed to correspond to it. As the chain becomes longer and longer, it is often divided into several smaller chains. This statement of Condillac is extremely important and also at the same time extremely complex. What Condillac tries to present here is that after our first contact with the reality, the sensuous contact, we have a perception of that thing, that reality. But we do not have just one contact, we have one contact after another or one perceptive experience after another, and this may be called a chain of experiences, and each experience leaves a trace on our consciousness. So, the signification, the understanding, the concept of the thing, of the object, is constituted slowly and slowly by a series of experiences which are based or which derive their correlations on analogy of signs, on the similarity, but analogy. We know that something that is analogous need not be similar or even identical, but it is considered to be analogous, it is considered to be correlated, and this is how the linguistic phenomena continues in the syntagmatic order, in the linear order. But what it shows is that he says that sometimes the most disparate ideas, most unrelated ideas also get mixed with each other in this chain of consciousness, in this chain of memory, which is a basis of the constitution of the universe of signification. Those who are familiar with the great French psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan should realize that the most important, most fundamental ideas of Lacan, of that statement that he made that the unconscious is constructed like language, that is in its syntagmatic and paradigmatic matter, is derived, the basis of that theory is in Condillac, in the 18th century philosopher, logician Condillac. And we will find, we will see later on also that several ideas of the modern structuralists, this refers directly to Lacan. Then there is another, will come very soon to the question of deconstruction. We all talk about the deconstruction of Derrida, but we will see that the idea of deconstruction comes, it is not a new idea in the 20th or 21st century, 20th century. It was already there in the French intellectual tradition, and especially with Condillac, who talked about it. And this, he says, this operation is called composition and decomposition of ideas. You see, if amongst our audience, those who are familiar with the ideas of Derrida, they should listen carefully to this statement. This operation is called composition and decomposition of ideas. With this method, we can compare them under all kinds of rapports. We can have a series of combinations. This method requires that we should be able to first recognize and distinguish the ideas that are simple, and in the order in which they are composed, the way they are combined with others. This reflection enables us to follow the reverse order, the order of decomposition. In Derrida, we talk only about deconstruction. In Condillac, there are parallel, there are correlative concepts, the concept of composition and the concept of decomposition. To understand a given object or given text or given unit of signification, we have to see how it is composed and how it is decomposed, see, how it is put together, how it is constructed and how it is deconstructed. And these are two sides of the same coin. See, this discussion is followed by reflections on affirmation, negation, reasoning, conceiving and understanding. When we compare ideas with each other, we become conscious of their location, their rapport, their correspondences, which enable us to affirm that an idea is. That is called affirmation. In the reverse order, we are able to state that it is not. That is called negation. This double operation is called judgment. See, in each case, whether it is composition, decomposition, whether it is dialectical interaction, it is always a question of comparing and understanding the location, even the existential situation of the object. Every object in this universe is existentially situated, and understanding of that object, that is existentially situation, is also an existential exercise which leads to the conceptualization of the object, and at the same time it is logical, it is dialectical. Condillac says, from the operation of judgment is deduced that of reasoning. Reasoning is nothing but a chain of judgments. Again, the word chain is very important, chain of judgments which are independent. When a person proposes to reason, the attention that he pays to the proposition that he wants to prove enables him to perceive successively, this is an important word, successively the principal propositions which are the result of the different parts of reasoning that he is going to follow. If their relation is well founded, he will be able to follow the exact order of relations and the exact correspondences with others. See, in any analysis, what is important is the exact order of relations and the exact correspondences. The elementary correspondences between the words and what they are supposed to signify is only a point of departure. This is also very important. It must follow the highly complex relationship between the signs and their significance, their evocative power, their grammatical rules, their logical constructs, their conceptual constructs, and above all, their combinations with other correlative and non-correlative signs. This is an extremely important statement, which in a way sums up what Condillac has said before. So, I repeat it. The elementary correspondences between the words and what they are supposed to signify is only a point of departure. It must follow the highly complex relationship between the signs and their significance, their evocative power, their grammatical rules, their logical constructs, their conceptual constructs, and above all, their combinations with other correlative and non-correlative signs. The sensations are only sensations. They become ideas only when our reflection makes them consider as images of certain things. The signs are the resultant of our judgments and rapports. If they are not frequently used for finding liaison between ideas and things, for conveying significant messages, they do not progress. It is their reciprocal communication that enriches our signs, which contributes to the progressive development of the operations of our spirit. See, the acquisition of language, the acquisition of the universe of signification, the acquisition of knowledge is a dynamic process. It is a continuous process. Finally, in the Buddhist tradition, the point of departure is the sense perception of the point instant reality, followed by the constitution of its image and the dichotomizing process of exclusions and negations. Now, the Condillacian enterprise is based on the process of abstraction. For Condillac, to abstract is to draw from or to separate one thing from another whose part it is. Consequently, the abstract ideas are partial ideas separated from their whole. Condillac refers to the prevalent theory of the ideas, that of Descartes and other philosophers. He says there are two opinions about these ideas. For some, the Cartesians, they are innate. The others believe that they are formed by the spirit. The former are wrong. The latter are not very convincing. The action of the senses is sufficient to contribute some abstract ideas. The spirit helps to produce more, and finally, with the concurrence of these two, we constitute a large number of them. With abstraction, we discover the rapport of resemblance and difference between the subjects. This leads to general ideas, which are only summarized ideas and abbreviated expressions. Condillac criticizes the realist philosophers of Europe, whose ideas are not very different from the Indian realists who are opposed by the Buddhist philosophers. They believe that the abstract natures are derived from the particulars. They are as real as the particulars. They do not realize that in the process of generalization, in the process of constituting new combinations of abstract ideas, especially those without any empirical model, we go far beyond the sensuous realities. The words honesty, humanity, truth, refer to highly complex combinations of abstract ideas, where the number and the method of combinations are more important than the real nature of abstract notions. For Condillac, the only way to acquire knowledge is to go to the origin of our ideas, to follow their generation, to compare them from all possible rapports. In other words, to decompose or to compose them methodically. This is a reference to the later development in the 20th century with Derrida. This is the veritable analysis of the ideas. There are some philosophers, argues Condillac, this is about 17th, 18th century philosophers, who divide this one method into separate parts. For them, analysis refers only to decompositional process, like for Derrida, Derrida's deconstruction, and the compositional aspect is considered synthesis. This gives the impression that one can choose any one of them. This is one reason why so many philosophers attempt to explain the composition and the generation of things that they had never decomposed or they had never apprehended in an analytical manner. This leads to an erroneous conclusion. How can a man, argues Condillac, establish the general principle of the mechanism of a clock that he has never opened and separated all the pieces to see how they are put together in a certain correlation that makes it function the way it does? See, this refers to the invention of clock, the timepiece in the 18th century, that he says that if you want to understand how it functions, we take all the pieces separately, and then if you can put them together in the proper correlation, and if it functions, if it works, that means you know how it functions. So, this is exactly the same thing with any text. If you have a text, if you have a unit that you want to understand, a linguistic unit, conceptual unit, or philosophical unit, you should be able to decompose and compose. You should be able to understand the correlations of all its elements, which lead to a whole, a unified whole of signification. All progress in knowledge, says Condillac, is due to analysis where decomposition and composition form the two aspects of the same method. Thank you.